Hi there, I'm Scott Blakely with Scott Blakely Bassoon Studios. The following video presentation is about bassoon reed wire adjustments. I'm sure you'll find it interesting, especially if you play bassoon. Stick around also for the end of the video, where I'll be demonstrating the Magic Fingers bassoon reed trick. Whether you just made an excellent bassoon reed or received a bassoon reed in the mail, chances are it's going to need to have its wires adjusted. In fact, if a reed is really well made from a good piece of cane, the vast majority of adjustments it's going to need after its initial scraping will be in the wires. Reeds go through all sorts of climate changes, with humidity and temperature, through shipping boxes and reed cases, bright concert lights, etc. So you should know how to do this. Since the adjustments I'm about to show you really are something that every bassoonist should know how to do, I want to go over some very basic reed anatomy. We've got the first wire, the second wire, the third wire, and some reed makers will use a fourth wire, although most do not, including myself. We have two blades. Between the blades and the first wire, there's usually a little bit of bark, which is called the collar. Between the first and second wire is the throat, and behind that is what we call the tube, and of course, the butt. I'm only going to be concerned with a few parts of the reed today, however. The first wire, the throat, the second wire, and the blades. I could draw a big diagram of different parts of the blades, but we're only going to be concerned about the tip opening, which is the opening when you look directly into a reed. It kind of has a bit of a football shape. Now, the beauty of adjusting wires is that any adjustment we make, we can undo. So you do not need to be afraid of adjusting the wires on your reed. You can always put them back to where they were. This is totally different than when we scrape our reeds with a file or a knife. You really don't need any tools at all to adjust the wires, but it's very helpful to have a pair of pliers. You can get a pair of reed pliers from any double reed shop. However, they're a little expensive, and if you're not making your own reeds, you certainly do not need them. What I recommend actually is a pair of mini linesman's pliers. You can find these online for less than $10. If you have a pair of larger pliers at home, that will work. The problem with large pliers is we're going to be making very small adjustments, so it's just a bit harder to control. So these mini pliers are great. The linesman pliers have a slightly wider jaw, and at some point in time it can be useful to have a wire cutter as well, which is part of the linesman pliers. Of course, if you don't have any pliers, you can just use your fingers, but that's going to make it very hard to be precise. Okay, so let's start by talking about the first wire. It's typically somewhat flattened, as really at this point in the reed, it's making a transition from a flatter shape at the tip opening to a round shape at the tube. So what happens if we open the first wire? In other words, if we squeeze on the sides of the reed, well, we're going to make the tip larger. But that's not the only thing that happens. We're also essentially making the tip narrower by raising the top and bottom of the blades. The sides are going to come in a little bit. In addition to that, we're increasing the intensity of the curve all around the blades in the corners and also at the top and bottom here. As the angle of the contact point between the two blades at the tip changes, there's going to be a potential for the pressure of the blades against each other to increase or decrease. This is going to be somewhat dependent upon how your first wire and second wires are adjusted, as well as things such as the width of the reed. If we close the first wire, the opposite is going to happen. The tip opening is going to get smaller and wider. The curvature of the reed is going to flatten to some degree, and the pressure of the blades against each other will very well change to some degree. At any rate, the angle of the contact point will certainly change. Closing time. Every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end. So now let's talk about the second wire. If the reed is well adjusted, it's typically quite round, but this can depend a bit on the design of the reed, where the wires are placed, the way the reed has been scraped, the shape that the reed maker uses, but it's often quite round. Sometimes it can be a little flatter. You'll pretty much never see a second wire that is what I would call more than round, in other words, a bit of an oval. It just does not work with the geometry of a bassoon reed. I did say earlier that you can undo any adjustment you make, so if you want to be a rascal and try it, go for it. Now let's talk about closing the second wire. The first thing I want to mention is that the effect of the second wire really depends on the placement of the wires as well as the shape of the cane. And if you really want to nerd out, we could talk about internal bevels, but we won't do that right now. So the first thing that happens is that the throat of the reed is going to become smaller. This is kind of the biggest airway in the reed, so we're choking that off a bit, and that's going to add a little bit of resistance. However, as the collar flattens, the blades are actually going to start to lift apart, somewhat like a pair of scissors or, I don't know, an alligator. The drawing here makes it look like you're going to see space between the blades, but that's not going to happen. What I want to show you is the way that they sort of split apart, so that they're going to split apart further towards the tip and less towards the collar. That means our tip opening, of course, is going to get larger. However, the curvature is not going to change as much as it did with the first wire adjustment. So as we open the second wire, the tip is actually going to close as the blades begin to press down on each other. And if they press enough on each other, it'll actually start to flatten the curvature of the reed as the corners start to press against each other.
Hey, are you some sort of cheap mini linesman's pliers?
Yeah, so what?
I'm a Scott Blakely reed, handmade of the finest Tunisian cane and 24 karat gold wires, and I would never ever be adjusted by the likes of you, cause I'm...
Yeah, shut up.
Speaking of tips, I have a few. First, you should always soak your reeds before you make these adjustments to prevent the slight possibility that you could crack your reed while adjusting the wires. Soak them in water, don't soak them in your mouth, don't soak them in Kool-Aid or vodka. Water. Not day-old water that you've had in your case for weeks. That's gross. Water. Fresh water. I also recommend, especially to those of you that haven't really done this at all before, is to start by experimenting on some old reeds. Don't expect the exact same results on your old reeds as your new reeds, especially if you're buying reeds from different people or you're new at making reeds and you have a lot of inconsistency in your reeds. And also, I would say, don't just be concerned with trying to make your reeds play better on those old reeds. Go ahead and really get to know the way these wires affect things. So try to make the reed really loud. Try to make it quiet. Make it ugly. Make it dark. Make it bright. See all the different things that you can adjust with just the wires. When you are working on a reed that you care about, however, a barely noticeable change can have a very big effect. So what I generally recommend is that you, when you squeeze a wire, you do it just enough that you notice that there's a change, and then you test it out. And sometimes you'll see a very big effect.
See that? That's plenty. Whoa, easy there, partner.
Remember, you can always change the wires back to where they were. And so if you're moving in very small amounts, that makes it easier to do. Adjusting the wires of your reed will affect its response, resistance, tone, projection, and intonation. There's a bunch of articles out there that will attempt to prescribe how each adjustment affects these things. However, I think they're all very interdependent upon other aspects of the reed, such as where the wires are placed, the shape of the cane, the hardness of the cane, the length of the reed, the way the reed is scraped. Also, the instrument, the bocal, the mouth, and the embouchure of the person playing, as well as what they're looking for in a reed. So my goal here has been to demonstrate the physical changes that happen as we make these adjustments. I think it's very easy for us to become biased based off of something our teacher tells us or that we read, even though our read might be made completely differently, or we might be playing it differently. In the most general and oversimplified terms, larger openings in the tip and throat will hinder response but aid projection. Wire adjustments can make a huge difference to any read. They can make something that was unplayable playable, and they can make something that was great crap. It will not fix all issues of a read, and it is definitely not a replacement for scraping a read with a knife or a file. It's not a replacement for making better reads or practicing or being a better musician, but it can definitely spare you a lot of frustration, and this will give anyone from a beginning player to an advanced reed maker more control over what they're doing. So I hope this helps. Happy practicing, brush your teeth every time before you play, and keep changing that reed water. So that was a lot of information that probably left you somewhat befuddled. I didn't understand any of this when I first started adjusting my wires. I barely understood it when I was in college or for several years afterwards, and I did just fine. The truth is, you're going to learn the most through experimenting with your reeds, far more than you will from any video presentation or article or confusing chart online. I hope I've been able to get you at least to think about the physical changes that happen to a reed and the way these mechanisms work. Now, as promised, I'd like to show you the Magic Fingers bassoon reed trick. I actually learned this from YouTube, watching a video masterclass by Ben Kamens at Music Academy of the West. And I'd like to show it to you now, because it's amazing, it requires no tools, and anyone can do it. The first thing I want to mention is that this usually has more of an effect on older reeds than newer reeds. And I should also say that the effect generally only lasts from anywhere from 1 to 15 minutes. Now, if you have a plaque, it's really helpful. If not, you can still do this without one. Make sure your hands are clean, by the way, before you do this. And you're just going to take your you're going to support the reed with one finger on one side, and on the other side you're just going to take your thumb and kind of give the reed a little massage here. Now, what I suspect is actually happening, why this has sometimes a startling effect on the reed. One, we're actually probably rubbing off a little bit of dead lip skin and decomposing cane. We're also compressing the fibers of the reed, making it a little denser. And the third thing that I suspect is going on is that we're reinforcing the internal structure of the blades, at least if we're using a plaque. If you don't use a plaque, you're not going to get that benefit. Anyways, let's hear how the reed crows. But now, it just so happens that I have a time machine and I can listen to how it crowed a moment ago before I did this. Let's also see how it sounds on the bassoon. Ooh, it is a lot more free right now, and it's easier to play that high F. It's not so out of tune. So that's the Magic Fingers trick. I hope it helps.
Happy practicing!